thank you very much. So I will talk today about the role of blue mussels in the Baltic Sea ecosystem. And I started working with blue mussels in the Baltic in 1970. And for the first 10 years, 1981, I did my PhD after 10 years or 11 years at that time. It took a long time, but I learned a lot about the mussels. Since then, I've only worked a little bit with mussels, but I'm still very interested in it. And what I will tell you today is to give you an overview. We have lots of publications on mussels. I have had about 10 PhD students working with different aspects of mussels and hard bottom ecology and so on. So in case there is something here which I don't explain enough in detail for you, you can come to me and I will give you references and reprints and so on. So just some basics about the Baltic Sea. You all know it's a salinity gradient, and one of the most tolerant species is the blue mussel, Mytilus edulis, which goes up here to about 4.5 per mil. And you also know that the number of species in the Baltic Sea is very much reduced. We have about 5,000 species of invertebrates here on the west coast, and here we have some hundred in the Baltic Sea. You can also see that some of the main predators of the mussels, like the crabs and the starfish, so on, they finish down here. So they are rather stressed by this environment here with the low salinity, the mussels, but they have no main predators. But I will come back a little bit about to the predation pressure. Well, these are two of the key species in the Baltic Sea, and I think Lena will talk a little bit about fucus. So this is a stressful environment, and you can see that, in fact, from just picking up a mussel. It's much smaller in the Baltic. This is a shell from the west coast, and this is a shell from the Baltic Sea. So you see, it's a huge difference in size. And that applies to all mussels. As you can see, 35 per mil, that's at the west coast, and then it goes down. They are about 7 centimeters there, and in the Baltic, in the upper Baltic, it's only about 2 centimeters. And the same for other mollusks. If we look at the freshwater species, freshwater mollusks, they also decline in size, but they are bigger in freshwater environments where they originated. So those are freshwater gastropods which get into the Baltic. They get smaller in the Baltic. But if you compare to another group of species like crustaceans, gammarus, amphipods, and isopods, they have the same size. And I will come up with some explanations to that also. So, but that's just the background. And here again, innermost distribution of blue mussels, innermost distributions of main predators. The real severe predators, starfish and crabs, don't go further until here, just inside the Danish Straits. And eider ducks and flounders, you can find them much higher up here. But as it is today, they are limited by other factors than food, because it's too many mussels for them. They never have any food limitation today, these. But we can come back to that also, because there is some people who argue that the reduction in the number of diving ducks, for example, in the Baltic Sea today is due to less food for them, less mussels for them. But I have not seen any differences in the amount of mussels. Maybe it's the quality of the mussels. Maybe there are more toxins in the mussels. It could have something to do with Tiaminas, for example. It could have something to do with cyanobacteria toxins or something being accumulated in mussels. But we don't know that. It's a lot of theories about it. But it's not related to biomass of mussels. So low salinity, few species, but many, many small mussels. And we did the study here. We have made calculations and done field studies and so on for this area here, the Swedish Baltic Sea coast, and down to 25 meters. We have calculated the biomass of mussels in this area and what they really do in this area, their role here, their role in circulation of matter and production and so on. So here they make up almost 90% of the benthic animal biomass down to 25 meters. It's 87% or something exactly. And totally it's 1.1 million tons dry weight along the Swedish coast and islands. Yeah. If we look at the west coast in Sweden, the mussels have a distribution along the shoreline, on the rocky shore, but they finish just below the water level, and that's because of the starfish coming in and predating on them, and the crabs. And if you find them deeper, it could be on a mussel farm where they have hanging ropes which don't extend down all the way to the bottom, because there they are protected from benthic predators. But that's a typical habitat, and you can see the potential for growth of mussels on the west coast in the Atlantic also, but it's definitely limited by the predation. Another place where you find mussels on the North Sea is on very shallow sediment bottoms, which get dried out during low tides, because that's also an environment where starfish and crabs cannot survive. So that's where the mussels can survive. And this is where you find the mussels in the Baltic Sea, down to 15 meters. This picture is from 10 to 15 meters depth in the Baltic. It's a carpet of mussels down there. You will never find them like this on the other side of Sweden, where there are predators. And you can have dense mats like this all the way up to 1 meter depth. And this is a shallow picture of mussels together with fucus. So we have a lot of small mussels in the Baltic. And I will talk a little bit now why they are so small and what they do, sort of. And again, going back to this about the size, it has to do with their osmoregulation. It's how to cope with the salinity. And crabs and the amphipods, which we had before, they are mainly osmoregulators. They can regulate their own salinity. They maintain a constant salinity like this, 25 parts per thousand in the blood, up to about 20. Well, but above that, they can increase the salinity also, which is good for their survival. But the mussels are osmoconformers, so they always have the same salinity in the cells as outside in the sea. And this is some of the more primitive species, like polychaetes, they have the same, whereas fish usually are perfect osmoregulators. Crustaceans are osmoregulators. And it has to do with you need some protection for yourselves. You need to have a shell or something to be able to osmoregulate efficiently. And if we look at the humans, we are also perfect osmoregulators. We have the same salinity in our blood, irrespective of where we are. And you can also extrapolate this, that if you are going to drown somewhere, it's better to fall into the water in the Baltic Sea, because you will not get any osmotic effects in your lungs, because it's about the same salinity or less similar salinity as in the blood and the Baltic Sea. It's much worse if you fall into the water in fresh water or in pure marine water. So, effects of salinity on mussel size and metabolism looks like this. Well, lower than 4 per mil, you can't find them. And then growth increases with the salinity, and they reach sort of the maximum size is already at about 15-20 per mil salinity. Does it have to do with filtration rate? No, because the filtration of the mussels is pretty much the same. So it doesn't have much to do with the food intake. Does it have to do with the expenditure, respiration? No, it doesn't change very much. It's a little bit higher here at the low level, but it can't explain everything. Does it have to do with nitrogen excretion? Well, here we begin to see significant effects. It's very high nitrogen excretion at low salinities compared to high salinities. So apparently they excrete nitrogen. And if we make a ratio between nitrogen excretion and oxygen respiration, we can see a very clear curve like this. So per amount of energy respired, they excrete very much nitrogen down here. And what does this have to do with osmoregulation and to keep the osmotic value in their cells constant? Well, it has to do with the biggest molecules which organisms have in their cells. That's amino acids and its proteins. So what they are doing, they are breaking down amino acids and excreting them. And of course, they are very energetic compounds also. So they lose energy. And this is something which we believe has to is the reason why they are smaller in the Baltic Sea. It's a very high energetic cost to maintain the osmotic value, because they are excreting and breaking down amino acids. So, and we have been calculated on the energy, what this corresponds to, and it can explain the differences in size and growth rate. So it's expensive to live in the Baltic Sea. Proteins and amino acids are metabolized. And some other tests we did was to move mussels, transplant them from the Baltic Sea to the North Sea to see what happens with them. Do they start to grow better, or what happens? These are mussels which have been remaining at Asker. This is the growth they have. They grow a little bit better here in July, August, September, and then when it's cold they grow slower again. These are mussels which we moved from Asker to Tjärnö on the west coast, and they started growing very quickly, and then they slowed down again during winter, and they reached the same growth rate as the North Sea mussels. You can see these started a little bit higher, but they are almost identical, the growth curves. So it's definitely the salinity which is the cause of the slower growth and smaller size in the Baltic. But there are some differences still remaining in the mussels. The shape and the thickness of the shell is still different. So this is an original Baltic mussel. This is what it looks like. This is the one which has been transplanted from the Baltic to the North Sea, and it has been growing, but you can see that the shell shape is still much more elongated as original North Sea mussels, which have been staying there all the time. These still have thin shells. So the growth increases, but the shell thickness is still very thin. And the North Sea mussels have thick shells. And another difference which you can note is that the size of the adductor muscle within the shells, which keeps the shell valves closed, is much smaller in the, well, also here I didn't indicate it. It's much smaller in Baltic mussels, and the size of the adductor muscle remains small, whereas in the North Sea mussels it's much larger. And we explain this by differences in the predation pressure. In the Baltic, you don't need thick shells. You have no crabs crushing shells. Why invest a lot of energy in that? You don't need a strong adductor muscle because there's no starfish which try to pull the shells apart. So you don't need to invest in that. And these differences remain, and you can also see it here. It's the transplanted mussels, the meat weight, and this is the native mussels, and everything is, it's only about half or even less. It's a very big difference. And definitely it has to do with predation pressure. But is this purely genetic or not? We have looked at the genetics of mussels and compared it, and there are genetic differences. Some people claim that there are different species even, that it's Mytilus trossulus in the Baltic and Mytilus edulis on the North Sea. But that is not true, because now there is a continuum. You have mixes. That's the latest now, they say. It's a mix of species. So you find these trossulus genes all the way up to northern Norway along the west coast. And furthermore, since Linnaeus described this species from the Baltic Sea, so if they want to change it, it should be Mytilus edulis in the Baltic, and then they can call the other Mytilus whatever they like. But it's we had long arguments with the geneticists about this, and I always claim that I'm an ecologist. I don't care what species it is. I'm more interested in the functions of it. Okay, that's a little bit about the size and genetics. Well, one more thing which is quite interesting, in fact, we have done experiments, student experiments. If you have a mussel in an aquarium and you expose it to water from an aquarium where there have been starfish, for example, they increase the size of the mussel quite quickly. You can measure it after 3 weeks that the mussel is increasing. If you have water from a crabs coming into the aquarium where you have mussels, they increase the shell thickness. So they change their metabolism and growth strategy depending if there is a scent of predators in the water. And they have another thing they do, is that if you spread them out and you have this water from a predator, they aggregate. They make small aggregations or balls and cling together also to protect from predation. So they're very smart animals. Remember that. They look very simple, but they are very smart.
Is that the Asker mussel or the West Coast?
That's West Coast mussels. And some other interesting things is if you put mussels in an aquarium, for example, you have one pile of mussels here, which is of West Coast origin and one of Baltic Sea origin, and put the predator in there, they always go directly to the Baltic Sea mussels and eat them. So they know from a distance which is the Baltic Sea mussels. And that is probably because they don't hide their scents or their smell. They don't need to do it, and so the predators know immediately where to go. And I've also tried, if you open them and you smell on them, they smell different, Baltic mussels and North Sea mussels. Even if the North Sea mussels or the Baltic mussels have been growing in the North Sea water for a long time, they still smell different. So it's something in their metabolism which is different. Okay, now going to what do the mussels do in the Baltic Sea? They are filter feeders. So they filter phytoplankton and particulate organic matter, and they produce nutrients, for example, and these nutrients can be used by benthic algae, and some of it is recycled to the pelagic system. They produce meat, which flounders and eider ducks eat as much as they like. There is no limitation for them. They produce feces, and there's lots of small animals who like to eat the mussel shit. And the biodiversity of small animals around mussel clumps is very much higher than outside mussel clumps. I will show you some data. And this, a nicer word than calling it shit is biodeposition by the mussels. We have tried to measure all those flows in different ways, and that's what I will try to summarize a little bit, how we have been doing it and what results we have come up with. Another thing I will talk a little bit about is how they contribute to resilience of the Baltic Sea, and if there are alternative stable states of the Baltic Sea and all that, you know, what we are speculating about. And just to see you, the idea behind this is a clear water lake where you have mussels and which filter the water. You have benthic biomass with mussels and vegetation that bind the nutrients, and they can prevent algal blooms from developing. And generally you have a high biodiversity in those types of lakes. And then you have the opposite, a eutrophic or a very eutrophic lake when there is no mussels and the plankton blooms dominate and prevent benthic vegetation to develop because they are shading out. It's too little light for benthic vegetation in those systems, and you get low biodiversity, you get oxygen problems. And this you have all heard about, but I will discuss this a little bit in relation to mussels. Do they have an impact on the Baltic Sea in this respect, or what are they doing? We have a lot of data since the early 70s, and I just to explain how we collected some of them, I can give this example. It's from, we had the Bjorkholm Sound Project 1974. It's a small strait just outside the Asker Laboratory. We will go there next week, so you will see what it looks like. And we shut this strait off, which is about, I think it's 300 or 400 meters long and 100 meters wide. And we measured everything day and night for 1 week. We looked at the production activity and so on, primary production, filtration of mussels, nutrient cycling, respiration of organism communities, and so on. And we did this in plastic enclosures, mesocosms, for the different subsystems here. And we even tried to fish the whole area, quantify fish and so on. So very much of the information I will be giving, it's not only from this, but it's using this type of methods, a lot of in situ studies, not any lab studies that we extrapolate, but rather mesocosm studies and in situ studies, which we then expand to the larger part of the Baltic Sea, extrapolate. And we did it all year round. Also, we can see this enclosure for mussels, for example. We can see it's very low activity in those during winter time, but then it's very high during summertime, and you get so we have interpolated it also over the year. And here again, it's a little bit one of the first pictures I showed about the role of the mussels. It's filter feeding, nutrient excretion, and biodeposition. And you can, from these mesocosm studies of mussels, which we were running over a year, every second or third week, during winter it was a little less, we could calculate that the mussels, the biomass of mussels, which is in the Ascoy area, which you don't know how big the Ascoy area we used. It's from Ascoy and all the way out to Landsort. It's 160 square kilometer area, which we defined as our primary research area. So it's pretty large and rather representative for a coastal area. And in that area, based on knowing how much mussels we have and what activities they have, which we calculated from these enclosures, we could calculate that just for maintenance of this mussel population, they need to filter 20-30% of the annual pelagic production. That was just for their maintenance. And it's a steady state population, so it's close to what they are using. And also the Ascoy area volume, this 160 square kilometer area, is filtered in about a month in winter. But it's rather deep and the mussels are not everywhere. So some parts of this area is filtered much more frequently than once per month, and some other areas are not filtered at all, probably. But in summer, they filter the water volume in down to 1 week already. And this is when it becomes very interesting, because the doubling time of phytoplankton is maybe 3 days or something like that, roughly. So if they filter at this rate, it's very close to filtering away the plankton production, the plankton that you have in the water. And in fact, you can see effects of this filtering efficiency. If you're swimming close to a bottom with mussels, it's very clear in the water. It's extremely clear in the water. And if you extrapolate to the total Baltic Sea volume, it filters the water of the Baltic in 1 year, theoretically. But this is also, the mussels are in one place and not all over. But you can compare this to the general residence time of water in the Baltic Sea, which is 25 to 30 years. So the mussels can filter the water 25 times in that period when you have the normal water exchange. And these nutrients, which are recirculated, they can supply benthic alga with 50% of the nitrogen and 100% of the phosphorus demand. And that's quite most probably what they do, because they are closely associated to each other. But there is still a surplus which could satisfy 7-16% of the pelagic nutrient demand. And I think these figures are not so surprising. I know, for example, in Francisco Bay, there is similar impacts of mussels on the pelagic system. So what happens here, the process is that the nutrients are filtered off from the pelagic system and deposited as feces or recirculated to benthic algae. And this biodeposition also has a significant effect on the benthic communities. The water is cleared and the benthic algae are favored, and a lot of nutrients are stored in mussel and benthic algae biomass. So this will reduce eutrophication effects in the system, because the nutrients, huge amounts of nutrients, are sort of tied up in the biomass. And this will then counteract flips of the system and improve the resilience. Exactly where these borderlines are, when a system will flip or not, we don't know. But anyway, with these amounts this impact that the mussels have, it will definitely be something that has to be included in any models. And mussels and red algae, I said they are close to each other and they are usually entangled in each other, and they are it's sort of a symbiotic relationship. The algae, they get nutrients and substrate. They can sit on the mussels and they get clear water also, so that improves their productivity. And the mussels also have benefits. They get substrate and protection. They can hide under this algae. It's very difficult for a fish to pick all the mussels under a sheet of algae like this. And here is what it looks sometimes. This is a seasonal or annual red algae, Polysiphonia phycoides, which is quite common on mussels, mussel bottoms. And here you can't see any mussels at all. And but it's a thick mat of mussels, and probably these red algae would not grow here if it wouldn't be that they were fertilized from below by the mussels. And in some places, we are now getting problems with red algae mats. For example, in Öland, where there are big beach casts of red algae coming now. This was before Linnaeus described that they had beach casts of bladderwrack, of fucus, which they collected and they put on their fields and so on, used as fertilizers. But now it's red algae, and you can't use them as fertilizers because there is a lot of problems with them. They contain brominated organic compounds, they contain heavy metals, and also the tourists, of course, don't like it. They want the white beaches here. So it's a lot of costs now to remove these algae. So every spring they go out with tractors like this and they collect these algae, and they then don't know what to do with them because they contain these compounds, and they are not allowed to use it to put it on the field. So they put it in the city dumps now or store it. And what will they do in the end with it? It takes a long time to break it down also.
Are there ideas about why they detach?
Yeah, they are seasonal algae, so they have a rather short growth period. So it's naturally that they detach. So they it's usually in August when they detach. They grow from end of May or May until August, then they detach, and in August, September.
So do they think they have increased because of eutrophication then, or is it linked to mussels?
It's linked to mussels, because it is on these mussel bottoms. And we have had some flips here already, and that is that the bladderwrack is reduced. It was before, and the bladderwrack has a sweeping effect. When there are waves, it will sweep away mussels on the bottom. And fucus can get 20 years old. So as long as it is there and sweeps the bottom, the mussels can't develop. But I think this was during the 70s and 80s when we had more eutrophication than we have now. Now the situation is improving. The mussels took over because they are benefited by phytoplankton, whereas bladder wrack is sort of, because it's less light in the water, they disappear. So there has been a shift, but this is only in these areas. Öland and Gotland, we have seen it so clearly. And this is the brominated compounds that they have. So a few years ago, not very long ago, everybody thought that the halogenated, brominated organic compounds, that was flame retardants. It was a pure product of humans and the contamination that we had been causing. But it's only not many years ago when Lena and others found out that it was naturally produced brominated organic compounds, similar to flame retardants that you find in this algae. Okay, biodeposition sounds better than shit production. We have measured biodeposition, and we did it in PVC tubes like this, about this size, about this height. And then we had here on top, we had a net where we put mussels, and then we had a net on top also to keep the mussels close to the opening. And we had a number of containers with mussels and of different amounts, and then we had some without any mussels at all, which collected the natural sedimentation. And this was quite interesting to do these studies. We did it during the whole season, and the idea was to see how much feces do the mussels produce. And to our surprise, the first thing we noticed was that the containers where we have mussels, we find much more sedimentation in there. And the organic content is much higher. It's much higher, much more in the ones with mussels, despite the fact that the plankton has passed the digestive tract of the mussels and the mussels have been growing. So we tried to find an explanation to that. And it's more organic matter and higher quality in traps with mussels. And that is because the mussels actively remove small nutrient-rich particles that would otherwise stay in suspension. They are about 5 to 10 microns. And that's where you have the peak also in plankton, is about somewhere down there. And those don't sink naturally. You don't find those plankton in sediment traps because they float. But the mussels, they suck them in actively from the water, and then they put them through their digestive tract, and they remove about 70 to 80%. But still, it's much more leaving the mussels than in the natural sedimentation traps. And this was quite interesting. It was the first time this was described, that the mussels are very strong agents of biodeposition in an ecosystem. I think it's similar. Zooplankton also have some similar activity, packaging organic matter, and then with a higher sinking rate. And it's of totally the biodeposition in the Aske area is of similar magnitude as the natural sedimentation in the coastal area. If we compare, for example, with what the sedimentation rate is at the Boyen station and extrapolating that to the whole area of Aske, comparing to what the mussels do. And this is what it looks like on a sediment bottom. This usually the mussels grow on the hard bottoms. That's their preferred substrate, but you can also find lots of them on sediment bottoms. And this is what it may look like. And here you can see how they aggregate a little bit I talked about before. And I had a student, Pia, who looked at these mussel clumps and the presence of mussels on sediment bottoms, how they affect biodiversity. How the size of the mussel patches affects biodiversity. And if we look, if there is no patch, for example, if it's between these patches, there you have on average two species on these bottoms, two species of benthic animals. But as soon as you have a patch, the number increases, and already at this size, when it's about 10 square centimeters or something, you're already up to almost 15 species. So it increases from two species to 10 to 15 species as soon as you have mussels present. So they mean a lot for the biodiversity.
Because they actively provide nutrients, or is it because they choose the right places where other?
I think it's all factors. I will summarize this just in a second. Yeah, I have another graph showing that. And also the same is for the number of alga species. Here it's no alga living on these sediment patches, but as soon as you have a mussel shell, of course, this can be colonized. It can be used as a substrate for benthic alga. So you can have five species immediately. And also you can see the effects of biodeposition. Here this is a little bit wave swept area, so this is the normal organic content of the sediments, and this is the organic content of patches where there are mussels. Also it increases in the sediment, organic content in the sediment under the mussels. But this is rather wave swept, so I think most of the feces, they're very fluffy, so they are flushed away. But here is what they do with the mussels. And now I chose this picture from the west coast because it's much more spectacular. You have the mussel clumps here, and you can see all species that are associated. Here is a shrimp looking at. There's a crab. Here is a small fish, a goby. There is another shrimp. There is lots of algae, some gastropods, some barnacles, and so on. So mussels, we call them ecosystem engineers because they modify the environment very much, and that's the reason why the number of species increases. So it's both structural traits here. You have the shell hiding place, for example, for organism, and then we have also the functional traits, which is the biodeposit production, nitrogen and phosphorus regeneration, filtration, and clear water, and so on. So all makes it nicer for these associated species. So they mean quite a lot for biodiversity. Well, as you can see, this is, I expand this original graph here, adding more and more information to it. And this picture shows a little bit the large-scale nutrient cycling in the coastal zone. We have nutrients coming from land, we have nutrients coming from nitrogen fixation, cyanobacteria. We have nutrients coming from offshore. We have nitrogen and phosphorus being released from the sediments, and we have the phosphorus trap in the below the halocline, and so on. So it's a lot of processes going on. But when we look at this, before we had the general idea was that the coastal zone serves as sort of a filter for filtering off nutrients coming from land. So the nutrients, effluents from human activities get into the coastal areas where they are taken up by vegetation and mussels and so on. But it's more and more now that we are talking about the coastal zone as a filter, because it's a lot of nutrients coming from outside also. And there are calculations showing by Baltic Nest Institute and so on that the amounts of nutrients coming from outside is 4 times larger than the amounts coming from land, in fact. And how does this function? The mussels clearly have a role in this process. And we are more and more talking about that the nutrients and organic matter are trapped in the coastal zone instead of being flushed out to the deep bottoms below the halocline, where they could cause oxygen depletion, for example. So this is a little bit of change in understanding of how the coastal zone works. So to you arriving late now, remember the coastal zone is not a filter, it's a trap for nutrients. That was the point here. And well, a lot of this trapping is due to mussels also. This is mussels again, a picture from the west coast, because they are even more beautiful there. This is a mussel farm. You can see ropes here, where ropes are hanging. Here's one in the front with a lot of mussels. And you can get the mussel, this distance here is about this size, so you can really see it's a lot of biomass growing. It's very clear in the water when you are diving here, except during reproduction. Then it gets like milk. Completely different. And what about reproduction of mussels? This is also something we have been studying. These graphs are now again from the Baltic. So I measured mussels of 30 millimeter length during a 2-year period, 1972-73. They were all 30 millimeter. I took away the shells and weighed the meat inside. And this is how the meat content of these 30 millimeter shells varied. Rather constant. Then during the spring bloom of phytoplankton, a very quick buildup of gonads. And then a very quick release again after when they spawn. And you can see both years, they double their biomass about here during the spring bloom. So they take up a lot of plankton. And then around 1st of June, that's when the temperature reaches 10 to 12 degrees in the water. Then you have an epidemic spawning in all of the mussels. So from having about 10,000 tons of mussels dry weight in the Aske area, during this short period from April, May, they doubled their weight. So suddenly we have 20,000 tons of mussels. And that is all gonads. It's rather impressive. Yeah, that is what I said. Main gonad buildup is during the spring bloom, and then they spawn again. So this amount, which spawning, is quite significant. It's a huge input of mussel larvae into the pelagic system. And these are then potential food also, for example, for herring, sprat, or whatever. And if you calculate how much this is in grams per square meter, it's similar magnitude as the zooplankton production, the annual zooplankton production in the area. But here we have to remember, all of this spawn is not reaching the pelagic system, because a lot is not fertilized. It falls down, it lies on the bed, it's eaten by a lot of other organisms. But still, potentially, this is a huge amount of larvae which are produced. And I think they may have an impact on the herring larvae production also, because the herring larvae are spawned or released at about the same time as the mussel larvae in the water, around early June. That's when you have the maximum amount of mussel larvae, and you also have the herring larvae in the water. In the Aske area, we have not found a lot of mussel larvae in the herring, but it might be a very short period when you have to look for it, for this peak. It could still be significant. I know from Germany, from Kiel, there are some scientists working with herring who find a lot of mussel larvae during a very, very short period. Probably a very important input for them. So, these mussel larvae, they graze on phytoplankton. So, depending on how many they are, they will probably have an impact, and then they serve as food for herring. And if you look at it for an area, for a coastal area, if you look at the storage compartments for nutrients in the coastal zone, we have calculated that the mussels, the benthic algae, and herring sprat are the largest living storage compartments for nutrients in the coastal zone. That's if you're making a nutrient budget, you really have to take into account all these components. Yeah, here is just some figures of carbon, nitrogen, phosphorus turnovers and so on. So we have been using this in modeling. I will not go into those details now, but instead discuss a little bit of what does this mean to us in terms of goods and services, for example. If we have these production and services of mussels related to nutrient cycling and eutrophication control, what is the magnitude of the value of this? And these are some very preliminary data, and it's not so easy to make these extrapolations, but we have anyway tried to do it. And the value of nutrients withheld from plankton production, we can look at how much we pay for removing nitrogen and phosphorus in a sewage treatment plant. It costs about 70 euros per kilo nitrogen and about 100 euros per kilo phosphorus to get rid of it in a sewage treatment plant. And looking then at how much is stored in mussel biomass, if the mussels are in this area of the Baltic Sea, which we studied along the coastal zone and Öland and Gotland, this just the amount stored has a value of 3.1 billion euros. If we wouldn't have mussels there, these nutrients would have been somewhere else in the ecosystem, and probably a lot of them would have been used in primary production and being causing eutrophication. the amounts deposited as feces is up to 7.2 billion euros per year. But part of this is recycled. They are deposited and then they are recycled again through microbial activity and so on. And the amounts that are recirculated to benthic alga and incorporated in benthic alga biomass is 3 billion euros per year. So you see, if you make these calculations, you very soon you get enormous amounts. So they definitely mean something for the nutrient dynamics of the Baltic Sea. We have some other services and functions which are partly not yet valued. For example, they contribute to increasing the secchi depth, which means that we have improved light conditions for benthic alga development. And as I mentioned before, the mussels can theoretically filter the total coastal water volume in about 2 weeks. I have no value on that. But we have made some estimates. The recreation value of 1 meter increased secchi depth in Stockholm archipelago is worth about 50 to 100 million euros per year, only for Stockholm archipelago. And that's Tore Söderqvist and his student who did these estimates. They just went out to the owners of summer houses and interviewed them. And based on those interviews, they made an estimate of how much the value of the summer houses would increase if the water was clearer. So there are some indirect methods how you can do this. And then we have a lot of other things which I mentioned, but where we have no ways of valuing it. For example, the larvae production, trapping of nutrients in the coastal zone. Probably this would, the mussels here affect the oxygen situation in the deep parts of the Baltic Sea below the halocline also, because the nutrients are retained in the coastal zone rather than being flushed out to the deep areas. They promote biodiversity, the small mussel clumps I talked about. They have a role in pollution cycling, and they contribute to improving the resilience and so on. But this is something where you can go on and make various estimates, and we are doing attempts to do this by different ways. We have also on the west coast, for example, they are now using mussel farming and ecological engineering to reduce nutrient emissions. And for example, in Lysekil municipality in West Sweden, the Lysekil was expanding quite a lot. So the sewage treatment plant which they had there didn't have enough capacity any longer. So there was a suggesting coming up, and I was one of the guys who suggested this, that we should farm mussels outside Lysekil and retain nutrients and then harvest the mussels, and then we remove them from the environment, and we would sort of have the same effect as a sewage treatment plant. It would be less eutrophication in the environment, and it would be a much cheaper ecological alternative to expanding the existing sewage treatment plant. And the calculations were made that the annual farming of 3,500 tons of mussels would be enough here, and that would be 100,000 euros cheaper than expanding the sewage treatment plant. But this did not work. And the problem was that the farmer, which was hired to do this, he was a cheater. So he didn't farm 3,500 tons, he farmed only 1,000 tons. And this was a little bit of a tricky business, because this was an exemption from EU rules that you should use the best available technique for water purification. And we had gotten exempt from this rule, a special approval of this project. But since he was cheating, they said, no, you will not be able to do this, continue this. But the problem was he said he had farmed 3,500 tons, but in fact it was only 1,000 tons. And then he showed some fake receipts and so on, that he had exported it to Belgium and France and so on. But I think this works. You can always argue you can't farm mussels in a sewage outlet directly and then use this for human consumption. But the idea here was that we were looking at the total bay or the total coastal area. And if you add nutrients at one end and you remove them at the other end, still, if there is a circulation in the bay, even if it's not the same nutrients, the nutrient status of the bay will be maintained. But here it is possible. I still think this works, or I'm sure it works, but we are not able to do it any longer. But now there have been discussions of doing the same in the Baltic, and Baltic 2020 invested a couple of millions in a big project farming mussels in the Baltic Sea, and then harvesting the mussels and then that way removing the nutrients. And there is one good idea about this compared to sewage treatment plants, because the sewage treatment plants, you need to catch the nutrients before they enter the Baltic or the sea. But with the mussel farm, you can remove nutrients already, even if they slip through your sewage treatment plant mesh. But we did already, this is my son, about 30 years ago, when we did some mussel farming experiments after Aske. And this is what the ropes look like after 2 years. And you could see the other ropes I showed before. After 2 years, you have this thick layer of mussels on the ropes. So it's positive. You have a very good settlement. It's very dense. So there are enough mussels, there are enough larvae in the water. But the negative things is it's too slow growth. It's too small size, and they accumulate too little nutrients. It's too little biomass. And also the byssus, the threads by which they attach to the ropes, are too weak. So if there is a storm coming or something, and especially when they grow large like this and it's turbulent water and so on, they may attach, because the byssus is quite weak in the Baltic Sea. And the small biomass, even after a long time, gives a very small effect and very high costs for the structure and maintenance of the system. So it's no way this can be economic. And they have given this up now. But there is another, unfortunately, another EU project which is starting based on those ideas. And I have all the time said that it's impossible to apply this to the Baltic Sea in this way. It will always be too expensive. Nobody can afford it. Yeah, that was the... But one thing we could do in the Baltic, and this is still now being implemented a little bit, is to farm mussels associated with fish farming in Åland, because in Åland they have farm fish, but they have reached capacity now. The Environmental Protection Agency says you're not allowed to farm anything more, because that will be too bad for the environment, because of eutrophication and nutrients being released. But we have now interested them to farm mussels, and that is based again on the concept, if we have a mussel farm and we remove a certain amount of nutrients, then we can be allowed to farm more fish to come up to the same nutrient levels. And if you do like this, then it's profitable. It depends on the price of the fish, if you can do it or not. So this is going on now, attempts, and it is possible. So, but it means that the fish farming permits can be increased now in this case. But there are many other factors involved also. But this is the only way of making it profitable. Finally, some speculations on the Baltic Sea. The presence of mussels in different parts of the Baltic Sea, the abundance of mussels is very different. Here in the Baltic proper, we have a lot of mussels, and that's the part of the Baltic I've been talking about now. In the Botnian Sea, we have much fewer mussels, and in the Botnian Bay, up in the north, we have very little mussels. And there are some models like this for the Baltic proper, and then for the other parts of the Baltic also, where you can see here we have filter feeders. It's mainly the blue mussels. And here we have a lot of energy being channeled to fisheries. In the Botnian Sea, where we have very few mussels, it's much less being channeled to fish production. And if we have no filter feeders like here, we don't have any net production of fish at all. It's a minus. All the fish which is in there, or the net amount, that's fish which have immigrated to the Botnian Bay. So for fish production, there seems to be also links. There are, of course, other factors which cause these differences. For example, the ice cover and light availability and other things. But a lot is also attributed to the mussels. And the presence of filter feeders, or absence of filter feeders, means a lot. Ragnar Elmgren has similar graphs showing the big differences between the different parts of the Baltic Sea, depending on if there are filter feeders or not. And then you can start also thinking about what happens if these mussels disappear. And what happens, for example, if we get a decrease in salinity in the Baltic Sea. It's simple picture of how it is today. We usually regard the Baltic as an oligotrophic, mesotrophic environment. And this is what it looks today. But if we get a more possible scenario, if the mussels disappear, and that could be due to lowered salinity, for example, invasion of a predator. We now have a monoculture, more or less, of mussels, and it's one species, more or less, filling the benthic filter feeder function in the Baltic Sea. If we have a predator coming in and reducing that biomass, we can get to this situation. Could also be a disease or a parasite coming in. It's a rather vulnerable system with only one significant benthic filter feeder. And then we would have a system, oxygen depletion in the sediments, in the deep water, much more primary production, eutrophication, no bladder wrack, no mussels, no cod, for example, maybe more sprat and herring. We don't know, but this is sort of possible scenarios. And of course, this could mean that the entire Baltic Sea could flip. And here we have one of those threats. It's the round gooby, Neogubius melanostomus, which comes from the Black Sea originally, but about 7 or 8 years it was introduced to the southern Baltic Sea, Polish coast, eastern Germany or Germany, Poland. And now it is spreading very much. So you have it all the way up to Finland on the Baltic side, on the east side of the coast. You also find it in Blekinge on the Swedish side, where it was found, I think, first time 2 years ago. But they are still small. They are growing. And this year they are probably mature and they will be reproducing. And this round gooby, it eats only mussels. So if we are lucky, it will be like with flounders and eiderducks, that there will be other factors limiting it. But if it's only food limited, there is no limitation for it. We can get as many as possible. And it already in the Baltic countries, there is a lot of interesting changes in the energy flow going on with this new species invading. I think this is a rather popular food for a cod also. So if the cod increases, maybe we would get even more cod if we have those fish. And it would be a way also of channeling some of this huge mussel biomass into something which is useful for us to eat. So we don't know. But it will be interesting to follow. And finally, what we usually talk about a lot is what potential effects are of global warming on the Baltic Sea ecosystem. And it's quite interesting if you use these models by Meyer et al., which shows that there may be very big changes in the salinity in the Baltic Sea. And we would get the salinity here of 4 to 5 per mil, which is here now. That's the innermost limit of both fucus and mussels. According to this model, that would maybe move to here. And we can easily see that will have drastic consequences to the Baltic Sea. So all the discussions that we have now, which I think is rather odd, is that we are mainly talking about pH and temperature effects on the marine environment. But I'm sure that these are not very relevant for the Baltic Sea. Salinity is much more relevant to put into focus. But maybe you have some other ideas.
What is the reason for this salinity decrease?
The salinity, it's mainly because there will be more precipitation, more rains over Scandinavia. And also, I think there will be a change in wind pattern and wave pattern. So there will be less salt water influxes into the Baltic Sea. Those are what the models are showing. But the discussion is mainly now is it's a lot being talked about pH, for example, and that's rather ridiculous in a Baltic Sea context, because the daily fluctuation is much larger than the changes that will occur over the next 100 years. If you look at a coastal community, for example, you can have pH changes between 7.5 and 9 or something in the algal community, where you have the mussels and and most of the life. So I think pH is probably, it might be relevant for oceanic conditions, but not in coastal areas like the Baltic Sea or even the North Sea. I think it's rather little pH effects. And temperature, of course, that will have some effects, but usually that, probably that will only mean for the Baltic Sea, it's a rather cold sea. If the temperature goes up, we will get more species in there, it will increase biodiversity. If it's an open coast, like here on the Atlantic coast, the limits of different species will move according to the temperature. But is that a problem? I don't know. So I would focus much more on salinity when we are talking about possible effects of global warming on the Baltic ecosystem. Yeah?